Will democracy survive the next couple of years?
And essentially, we are the same.
Can't have government choosing winners or losers.
There are so many needs that Minnesota has.
What people are saying they need right now.
Access to Democracy is made possible in part by a donation from Firefly Credit Union. Firefly is the new name of U.S. Federal Credit Union, which has proudly served the financial needs of the greater Twin Cities community since 1925. At Firefly, we guide our members forward and give them the power to chase dreams by delivering the financial solutions they need to get ahead. From checking accounts to mortgages, we'll light the way. We are Firefly Credit Union, and this is Life Illuminated. By Thomson Reuters, providing legal professionals with intelligence, technology, and human expertise they need to find trusted answers. Thomson Reuters, the answer company. Online at thomsonreuters.com. And Dr. Charles Crutchfield of award-winning Crutchfield Dermatology in Eagan. Acknowledged as one of the nation's best physicians, a Minnesota native who trained at the Mayo Clinic, Dr. Crutchfield personally treats all patients and states that experience counts and quality matters. Crutchfield Dermatology, look good, feel great, with beautiful skin.
Welcome 2019, welcome to Access to Democracy. Alan Miller back with you. We have a first time guest, Melodie Bahan, who is the executive director of Minnesota Film and TV, and while we've had the organization on before, this is the first time in your 2 years that you've been here, so welcome.
Thank you, I'm thrilled to be here.
Well, we're really happy to have you, and we are big supporters of the film and TV program, which we'll talk about.
Great.
How about a little background?
All right. Well, I professionally started my career in New York City, working in city politics. Moved to Minnesota to go to the University of Minnesota in journalism, and spent a decade or more working at the Guthrie Theater, and then for an organization called ArtSpace, a nonprofit real estate developer. And then landed what is really my dream job as executive director of Minnesota Film and TV.
And because it's been 2 years since we've had anybody here from Minnesota Film and TV, give the audience a little bit of a background on what it does.
All right, Minnesota Film and TV is a nonprofit organization that serves as Minnesota's film commission, our state film office, but we are a nonprofit, not part of the government. We exist to support and advocate for Minnesota's production industry, to attract productions to Minnesota, to market the state to the industry, and to administer the state's production incentive program.
Which we used to call Snowbate, but we're getting away from Snowbate.
We are. Right now we're just referring to it as the production incentive program, which is a rebate program currently.
And well, we don't have that much snow here so far, so that.
Well, and the one thing that we don't need to tell people in the film and TV industry is that Minnesota has snow. So I think we'll move away from that.
Except when they're doing Grumpy Old Men or True. Grumpy Old Men 2.
True.
And films like that. Now, we talk about incentives. Mm-hmm. What type of incentives? We want to induce producers, directors. It used to be basically just film, but now it's TV production also.
Right.
We want them to come here and film their projects.
Right.
So, what incentives do we offer them? Where do we get those incentives? And I hope the legislature is listening.
Yeah. Well, do you mind if I go back and talk a little bit about the history of
Not at
that?
All.
All right. A lot of people remember films like Grumpy Old Men and Mighty Ducks and those years back in the 80s and early 90s when there was a lot of film production here in Minnesota. What is different now is the introduction of production incentives. And incentives are investments that the state makes, either in the form of rebates or tax credits. That they offer to film producers, film and television producers, to as a way to offset some of the costs that they incur. And these are incentives that are offered on money that is spent in the state. So it's new money that's brought into the state and spent here. And production incentives were created. Minnesota was actually one of the first states to do it, as a way to fight back against Canada. Minnesota, well, all of the country was losing a lot of film production to Canada because Canada was offering production incentives. So Minnesota and a couple of other states decided that they would implement incentive programs to try and lure some of that production back.
And today we're competing with a bunch of other states who are making at least as attractive, if not more attractive, offers to induce people to go to their states.
Exactly. So right now, you know, obviously California and New York will continue to be leaders in film and TV production. Those are hubs. But states like Georgia, Louisiana, Illinois, New Jersey has just relaunched their tax credit program. Pennsylvania are all very, very competitive. Minnesota has not kept up with these states in what we're able to offer in terms of just the state investment. We have a tremendous amount to offer productions in terms of locations and professional crew base and weather, geography, all of that.
Certainly one of the best any place in the country.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. So. So the production incentive that Minnesota offers right now is a rebate. We are heading into a legislative session, and our rebate is funded by a legislative appropriation. So we will be asking the legislature to fund that rebate program. But in addition, this year we are asking for them to pass a tax credit incentive, and that will allow us to compete for those larger budget film projects, and more importantly, as you alluded to, television. So much of the content that's being created now, and the really great content, is on what we refer to as television, but it's streaming, you know, it's basically episodic programming, whether it's Netflix or
HBO. All things that I don't understand, but
yeah. But it's what people are watching, and it's where some great work is being done, and frankly, it's where billions and billions of dollars are being spent. So in order to make Minnesota attractive to a series, we need an incentive that's going to be stable and that's going to be around for more than a year.
What legislators don't necessarily understand, and they do have a lot on their plate, but we're coming into a year where we have a surplus of someplace between $1.6 and $2 billion, which is a good time to go for money, I think. But they don't understand that when a film production comes here, it creates jobs across the board, down to people who taxi the actors back and forth, to hotel space or motel space, I can just go on and on and on. It gives our local people jobs, and we have so many talented local people who are ready to step in, from being the carpenters to being really the actors themselves. And we have a great acting base here also.
That's
one
right.
of the best in the country, probably, I think, second only to New York, frankly.
I would agree.
And, so they have to understand that this brings in tremendous amount of money. Now, last year, they, I think, authorized $500,000, which frankly goes no place. It doesn't even stretch over possibly one production.
Right, right. I think, you know, as an example, just to kind of break it down for folks, if we were able to attract a television series here, let's say a 1-hour drama series, that would have a minimum of 10 episodes per season. A drama series costs about $3 to $4 million per episode. So you're talking $30 to $40 million injected into our state economy in a year, and that will go over multiple years. A successful series can run, you know, 3, 5, 7, 10
you know,
years.
Look at a series like Blue Bloods on CBS.
Yeah.
I think they're 10 or 12 years in now.
Exactly.
And there are others like that.
Yeah. And you look at some of these series, what the series that are shot outside of the hubs of New York and LA, what they have done for the local economies where they're shot. You know, a series like Breaking Bad was shot in Albuquerque, New Mexico. It changed that city. It revitalized their economy. The same for a series like Walking Dead, which was shot in a little town outside of Atlanta, Georgia. That town was almost shuttered completely, and now it is this thriving town that has not only benefited from the influx of the production dollars, it's now benefiting from tourism.
And because of the size of this state, we have just about any time period. If you want a small village, well, we have cities here as small as 390 people, but we can find that. If you want something period piece, we can find that. If you want something really strikingly modern, we can find that.
Absolutely.
If you want a riverfront, we have a river called the Mississippi, which sometimes is attractive to people, and the St. Croix, et cetera. So there is so much here to offer, and your job, I guess, is to get that message to the legislators. And you ought to make them sit and listen to this interview.
I'll do my best.
And I know our local legislators are tuned in because I'm on their case.
Yeah.
But we need that all over the state.
Yeah.
Well, fortunately now, we go out to 28 cities. We used to be just Eagan and Burnsville, but now the show is available to 28 downstate cities, so a lot more people will be seeing it, and a lot more legislators will be seeing it
than
in years past, because the upgrade of equipment has really, really benefited us in that regard, and benefited them, because what we have here in terms of a facility is not equaled by very many places, if any, in the state. So we just make it available to them, and I waive the copyright on it, and you know, let's cross our fingers.
Yeah.
But so that said, let's talk about, as I was doing some research here, we mentioned Grumpy Old Men, Grumpy Old Men 2, Fargo, Prairie Home Companion, A Serious Man, the Coen brothers, Purple Rain, Simple Plan, Mighty Ducks, Sweetland, Dear White People, and the movie in which I starred, Into Temptation.
Yes.
You laugh.
I'm sorry. Yes.
For my 8 seconds of non-speaking on screen.
But you got a kiss from the leading man.
I got a kiss from a leading man, and I threatened him as a result of it. But they were all shot here.
Yeah.
They all benefited not only the state because of the jobs they created, but it's good for tourism because
Absolutely.
It really brings, I mean, we have, for instance, a state capital that is as beautiful as any state capital in the country. And it's available to work into shots and things like that. So
one of the other things that I think is really important and we're trying to impress upon legislators is that there are films being planned, films that are in development, projects that are in development that are Minnesota stories. They're set in Minnesota. They're written to be shot in Minnesota.
Sweetland is a perfect example.
Yes, but without a strong incentive program, those films are going to be shot in Canada or in Illinois or in Pennsylvania. They're going to make it look like Minnesota. So I think there's an element of pride that we need to think about. There's one in particular you remember Zach Sobiak, the young man who had brain cancer and wrote a song.
Right.
Recorded a video that was just took the...
Went viral.
Went viral. His mother, Laura, wrote a book that has been optioned for a film. It's in development, and that, by all rights, ought to be shot in Minnesota with Minnesota workers and Minnesota crew. If we don't get the incentive program up and running again, they'll take that film somewhere else, and they'll make Canada look like Stillwater.
Well, you mentioned Patchogue, Long Island.
Yeah, yeah.
Where I happened to go to high school.
Mm-hmm.
Patchogue, Long Island was where they filmed Born on the 4th of July.
Right.
The Tom Cruise.
Tom Cruise, right.
Why? Because they made it look like a town, I believe, in Texas.
Mm-hmm.
In the 50s or something like that. They couldn't find the right location.
Mm-hmm.
They filmed it in Patchogue, and they made Patchogue fit the descriptions.
Right.
That's what we don't want to happen
right.
with Minnesota stories. And we happen to have some great authors here in Minnesota who are now optioning their books. We've had quite a few mm-hmm. of them on here, David House Wright and Freeman, who Brian Freeman has
oh, yeah.
a book coming out, Matt Goldman,
mm-hmm.
Even I'm trying to think of, well, a couple of the others
yeah.
that we've had
well, we
on the show.
Well, we have such a strong literary community here. Those writers' work ought to be, you know, optioned for films, and those ought to be made here.
And they write thrillers about Minnesota,
exactly.
whether it's Duluth or St. Paul or, you know, elsewhere through the state.
Mm-hmm.
John Sanford probably is the most right. well-known nationally.
Right.
Those films, by rights, should be shot here,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
and
but,
they could be.
Yeah, but, you know, we can handle more than just Minnesota stories. As you were saying earlier, you know, we have such a wide variety of geography and locations. Minnesota can double for just about any place other than maybe the tropics. So we can look like other locations.
Well, southern Minnesota would be the tropics.
Oh, there you go. Well, yeah. So, I mean, we've got shoreline with the Great Lakes.
Rochester and the Mayo Clinic. And, you know, if you want to do a medical facility, and there was just a good film the Ken Burns documentary.
Mm-hmm.
And documentaries are another area
right.
of nonfiction that mm-hmm. really, really lend themselves to being here.
And we've got some really incredible local documentary filmmakers here in Minnesota. We have some great filmmakers, period, in Minnesota. People that are, you know, local filmmakers who are even, you know, without an incentive program, working at very, very low budgets. There's so much talent and creativity. They could be doing so much more. And we hope to support them and not just import projects to the state, but export their work out to the rest of the world.
Now, there is a workforce training program at Minneapolis College, which is one of the few places that has a screenwriting program.
Mm-hmm.
Tell us a little bit about that.
That's a program that we are just developing. We are partnering with Minneapolis College to develop a program because we realize that once we are successful in building back our incentive program, which I'm confident we will be, we know that the work is going to come here. We know that projects are going to want to shoot here. We know that we have a very strong and professional crew base, but there's no pipeline. Where are the new people coming to fill in those crew positions? So we decided what we needed to do was create a program that can bring young people, particularly young people of color, which the crew base is frankly lacking, into the industry. It is, you know, to start in the production industry as a production assistant is such a great opportunity for a young person because you don't need post-secondary education. You need basically, you know, a basic training of what to do, a willingness to learn, and a willingness to work hard. And you can work your way up to a union job, a good middle-class living, or more. So we're partnering, as I said, with MCTC, Minneapolis College, to develop this program that we want to launch in conjunction with the Strong Incentive Program. What we don't want to do is...
Our director right now, Raven, is a graduate of that program.
I have nothing but respect, all respect to Minneapolis College. They are great partners, and I think it's going to be a fantastic program.
And another thing I wanted to mention is the Independent Television Festival,
yes,
which has been in various places around the country for 13 years. Now it's going to anchor this year and hopefully in the future.
Forever.
In Duluth.
Yes, yes.
Which is another location that really lends itself to production.
Yeah. We are so excited about bringing this. I mean, talk about potential economic development. I met the executive director of this festival last year, and we started talking about the festival and its future. It has been located in Vermont for the last 6 years or so, and it just wasn't, it had reached its growth potential in Vermont. And so I suggested that he look at Duluth. I went to Duluth, I talked to the mayor, I talked to the economic development folks. They were interested, so it was a little bit of matchmaking, and we announced that they're moving here. We announced that in December, and in October of this year, we will be bringing studio and network executives from both coasts, along with
like 1,400 people or 1,400 production companies, et cetera, which is really tremendous.
Yeah, last year the festival was sponsored by HBO and the Television Academy, so that's the level we're working at. This is great for Duluth, it's great for Minnesota filmmakers, it's great for the state as a whole, because we will have all of these decision makers coming to Minnesota, some of them for the first time, and we will have the opportunity to show them what we have to offer here.
Put them on a bus and take them around.
Exactly. I will be meeting them at the airport and driving them to Duluth myself.
Now, there's also an incentive from the Iron Range Resource and Rehabilitation Organization. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that's the IRRRB, where its name has changed, but everyone refers to it as the IRRRB, had a production incentive years ago, and it supported a couple of film projects, and it kind of languished. Nobody really knew how to manage it, run it. So we started talking with Mark Phillips, the commissioner up there, and the IRRRB, Mark and the IRRRB have provided a grant to our office to relaunch that incentive program for the Arrowhead region. And so that one is in place, and we have funds available for that.
In fact, we had a film that was made on the Iron Range a few years ago with a well-known actress, I'm trying to remember, or actor, they're not actresses anymore, about labor.
North Country.
Right.
Yeah, and I believe, I may be incorrect, but I believe that the incentive, the Iron Range incentive, was started as a result
project. Which is why I brought it up.
It was Charlize Theron.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah.
An Academy Award winning actor.
Yes, yes.
And yeah.
Yeah. So we've relaunched that program, it's a 20% rebate incentive on expenses incurred within the range, within the Arrowhead. We're just really excited about that.
These rebates basically benefit Minnesota residents, mm-hmm. Minnesota vendors,
exactly.
Minnesota businesses,
right.
Really, right. It's a win-win for the state,
right?
But because we have to have the financial backing to do it.
Right, it is an investment. It is not, you know, the expenses that are that qualify for the incentive. It's expenses that occur within the state, so it is resident workers. It is materials purchased in the state. It is hotel. Apartment rentals within the state, so benefiting property owners, food, restaurants, catering, all of that. It's money that goes to Minnesotans and stays here in the state.
And we also didn't even talk about the Boundary Waters, but what a great location. And Kruger writes a series of really very popular books about the Boundary Waters, and we'll have to get you into one of those, because he's
like
got
to.
Like 14 or 15, and Native Americans are very prominent in it, mm-hmm. and with his lead character, who's recurring,
mm-hmm.
and they're really excellent books. I don't know if any has been made into a movie, but certainly some should have
mm-hmm.
by now.
There and are so many authors,
An inexpensive movie in terms of locations and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And of course, we have sound stages here.
Small ones. We don't have a massive soundstage that could support, you know, a television series for, you know, that's going to be shooting on sets.
Well, unfortunately, we have some stores that have gone out.
Well,
and those are locations like Sears and like some of the supermarkets that we, you know, might look at in that regard.
That's exactly right. And, you know, when I talk to production executives at various studios and location managers, they certainly ask about soundstage availability, but they also say, well, do you have an empty warehouse? Do you have a convention center? Do you have something else that we can use?
And we do.
And we do.
And we actually have used up most of our time.
Oh, you're kidding.
And see how fast a half hour goes when you get into what you're doing.
Well, I'll have to come back.
Well, absolutely. We want you back. And if necessary, you know, we'll give you a copy of this program and give it to every legislator.
I will.
We've been speaking with Melodie Bahan, the executive director of Minnesota Film and TV Commission. And I thank you so much for coming in. It was a very informative interview, and you will come back, and we'll do this time and again. And thank you again.
Thank you.